I welcome all of you to our Holistic Health series on Fridays. I'll turn off the slide. And I really am so happy that you're here and to share in the program. I'm your host, Eric Pepper. I'm a faculty member at the Institute for Holistic Health Studies at San Francisco State. And this program is part of a series sponsored by the Institute of Holistic Health Studies and the Department of Recreation, Parks, Tourism, and Holistic Health at San Francisco State. And we offer Fridays from 12 to 1. The purpose is to provide a holistic health perspective and approach to optimize health and well-being. As so many people continue to report physical, health, mental, social challenges. For example, in a recent student survey of my upper division students, 85% report experiencing anxiety and depression. 48% neck and shoulder tension. Well, what do you expect when you sit at the computer the whole day? 41% some abdominal discomfort. And at the same time, 75% of students in the CSU, the California State University System, state that well-being services like mindfulness, relaxation, meditation would be helpful, but only 25% feel their school is doing this. And many students report that they want to learn stress management, lifelong learning skills. And that is one of the benefits of taking courses in holistic health and in the Department of Parks, of Recreation, Parks, and Tourism. In that way, one can learn healthy ways to cope with stress. We learn that communication and community is key. We can learn to value other cultures and traditions that are just different from us. And we can even learn ways to move into nature, which is healing. And I'm so fortunate to be part of this program, as 80% of the students say that holistic health classes help them manage stress. These classes can fulfill the upper divisions for general education. They can take a minor, they can take a certificate in holistic health, or they can major in recreation, parks, and tourism. They are all strategies to create a healthy lifestyle and gain awareness. With that introduction, I'm so honored to introduce our speaker for today. What we'll do is our speaker will talk for approximately 45 minutes and will be open for questions at the end or even during. He'll have total control over the presentation. So the speaker is my colleague and long-term friend, Richard Harvey. He's also a professor in the Institute for Holistic Health Studies at San Francisco State, where he teaches a class called Psychophysiology of Healing, Relaxation and Stress, and is a role model of what to do. And so with much ado, and such pleasure to introduce our speaker, Rick Harvey, who will talk.
Welcome, everybody. Thanks for being here. So in the chat on the Zoom call, you'll notice three broad general abstract questions. Those are, what is Hardiness, what is psychoneuroimmunology? And the last one is a simpler question. What do you want to know today? What do you want to learn? And you might have some preconceptions about the talk. However, I'm going to show you a set of slides from a PowerPoint presentation. The purpose of showing you the slides is to let us know where we're going to be headed today. And when I have you look at these large number of slides, there's a moment to answer these questions. So I'm going to start with this slide, which is the title slide. Oops. The title slide is here. Hardiness at Work, Psychoneuroimmunological Buffers Against Stress Reactions. I'm stopping the slide and I'll go into the slide, but before I do, I want to hear from you. Is there something that you want to make sure that's covered today? There's a large number of bits of information to discuss, but either unmute or drop into the chat and answer to some of those questions. And what do you want to learn today? Kelsey, what do you want to make sure to hear about?
Yeah. I'm a master's student in the econ program, and I I just would like to have your guys' perspectives on like the online learning that is very stressful and debilitating to my mental health. But despite all of the statistics that Professor, I don't know how to pronounce your name, but
Pepper
mentioned, people at the same time are still voting to stay online in all of our like surveys of what format of classes do people want. And so I'm really, really curious about, people are saying they're really, you know, not, they need help with stress management and mental health and stuff, but I don't understand how we're all doing that in our homes.
Yeah. And I will keep your comments in mind as we go forward. And that's a really, really good thing. Let me hear from some other folks just briefly. I'm going to do like a classroom in the sense of, let me call on some folks. Stefan, if you're able to unmute, what do you want to learn today? What do you want to make sure to get out of today's session? Putting him on the spot. Okay, the mic isn't working. Let me see who else wants to be put on the spot. Tracy.
Or if you don't want to be put on the spot, just put the question in, put your comment into the chat.
Put your comments in the chat. Yeah, thank you, Eric. All right, so with no further ado, let me go ahead and begin the conversation and tell you where we're heading. The first slide, and this is a slideshow presentation component, is, it's not showing up. This is going to sound strange, but my screen just went blank. There we go. Now I can see it. Sorry about that, a little technical trouble. In the left-hand corner of the slide is an image. The abstraction is that exposure to difficulty, whatever that is, and it says exposure to trauma, leads to both acute, meaning short-term, as well as long-term problems that are chronic. There's a well-understood set of influences of exposure to difficult life circumstances. Whatever those difficult life circumstances are, they are held in place by this exposure to trauma that influences down the line later life outcomes. Those responses to trauma that have fairly well understood biological mechanisms include challenges with your gut. So gut dysbiosis is the fancy terminology that says you got a stomach ache. There are other types of psychological issues, poor sleep, substance use and overuse, different types of food and mood relationships. So abstractly, the behaviors that we deal with are things like, broadly speaking, how we're eating, how we're sleeping, how we're relaxing, or oppositely, how we're not eating well or not sleeping well or not be able to relax or release ourselves. The construct that we're going to talk about today is this idea of psychological hardiness. Imagine, if you would, a relative point, a line, horizontally speaking. When you're below the line, you're in a negative way. You are anxious, you're nervous, you're depressed, you're angry, or you're injured in some ways. You have diabetes, obesity, HIV, AIDS, heart disease, some kind of problem is in your life. And sometimes, sadly, all at the same time. The argument is that you're resilient when you bounce back to the way things are. You're optimistic when you look forward to getting back to base. Hardiness is a slightly different psychological construct. It says you want to do things in service to learning and growth. You want to go above and beyond your line, knowing that it's difficult to change behavior, to change. You can't change the past, you can't change the weather, you can't change the economy, you can't change COVID exposure or disease processes, but what you can do are the following things. Hardiness in this conversation today will be about having the courage to push yourself above and beyond your reference point where you were before. So in service to that idea, the abstraction of what distinguishes hardiness from other types of resiliency and optimism and positive psychological traits is that it comes from a school of existential psychology. Now, that's a little bit of a fancy term. Existentialism is saying, what's my meaning here? What am I doing here? Why am I doing what I'm doing? And so in a little while, we'll come back to that notion of how do we push ourselves when we find meaning? And it's almost like the distinction between pain versus suffering, where pain is a difficulty which is kind of endemic to the human experience. Things are difficult. Things can be painful. The difference is, if you know why that pain is in your life or why you're struggling, then there's meaning behind it. And the example was from a soldier in the Great World Wars, World War II, lost their leg. And they said, you know, I'm in pain every day, but I know that I lost my leg for a good cause. And if you talk to some of the Vietnam era or more modern day warfare era soldiers, they'll say, I lost my leg, but I do not know why. And I suffer every day on top of my pain. So we're going to distinguish between the meaning finding activity, which is kind of the centerpiece of the psychological hardiness concept, compared to resiliency and optimism. And again, grit and positive mindsets, other terms along those lines. Here's the next slide in the share. Not only are we going to talk about how having this attitude of finding meaning is worthwhile, because meaning finding can serve as a buffer against those difficult life circumstances. It can take the edge off if you know why and what the struggle is about. We're also going to discuss this notion of how your thoughts, your attitudes, your beliefs about those difficulties can influence your immune system and other body systems. There will be some technical terms, and we'll unpack some of those technical terms. And then we'll throw in a few fun activities as we go along. And again, just to respond to the chat, yes, we will get not only to the questions that were raised about how, from an economics point of view, people are choosing to stay online and deal with all the stresses of online work, but also of the stresses related to, say, of being a working mother, as Tracy put into the chat. So here's one more concept. There are three interacting attitudes. These attitudes have simple names, sort of the three C's of psychological hardiness: challenge, commitment, and control, control, commitment, challenge, commitment, control, challenge, regardless of where you start. The set of attitudes came from work by Salvador Matty. Less than a year ago, Sal died, so sadly, and he was my mentor and dissertation advisor. So I'm very familiar with his work, and we co-authored a number of papers on the topic of psychological hardiness. The main or the central theme in having the word courage in here is knowing that things are difficult, but you still push or press forward regardless of those difficulties. That's the central theme in the hardiness concept. Let's start off with challenge. When things are difficult, you can have an interpretation. I know this is hard, but I can learn and grow from the experience. I don't only want to expect the way things were. The way things were might have been comfortable, might have even been secure. That is to say, I don't want to expect ease and comfort every day. I want to be able to challenge myself and learn and grow through the process. So that's sort of one of the main attitudes, or the first attitude on this list. The second one is, it's going to take a little bit of effort. I got to commit myself to this. I want to involve myself in a way that continues finding meaning despite the challenges. I don't want to simply detach or distract myself, especially in a world that's filled with distractions of many kinds. The last is What is it that I'm able to influence versus those things that I have no control over? Rather than feeling powerless, I am powerless per se to change the, you know, bomb cyclone weather patterns that come my way, or wildfires, or the exposure to viruses that cause COVID. Those things I might be powerless against. However, what I am empowered to do is to wear masks and keep physical distance. Or what I am empowered to do, I can control and influence certain aspects of how I protect my house from rainy weathers and stormy weathers and wildfires. So the degree to which I'm willing to struggle in order to influence the outcomes, the degree to which I'm willing to involve myself in continually finding the meaning, and the degree to which I can continue to learn and grow from difficulty, are these three attitudes that combine, call them hardiness attitudes, that give rise to this abstraction called hardy courage or hardiness. I'm going to hit pause and check in with folks if there are any comments or questions, because we're about to shift gears a little bit to the abstract notion of how does this set of thoughts, your interpretation, your meaning finding, influence your body and our stress reactions, the immune system in particular, as we go forward. If there are no comments and questions, and at any time I'll be monitoring the chat, feel free to go ahead and just drop a question into the chat as we go further. So here we are with some technical terms. I added in this endocrine word, psychoendocrine neuroimmunology. And this model, PENI, or PNI for some folks, psychoneuroimmunology is the most common, but psychoendocrine immune or psychoendocrine neuroimmune relationships, it, for 20, maybe even 30 years, arguably 40, 50 years ago, there were models that were very similar to the one that you see now. I'm showing a 20-year-old model by Ulf et al. And here's the abstraction. We have a set of coping strategies, whatever coping means. And in this case, in parenthesis, it says hardiness. The argument is that hardiness is a way to cope that leads to different types of reactions. Coping, or your attitudes and your beliefs, influence how you interpret something as a stressful event. That is to say, given exposure to difficulty, something called a stressor, abstractly, put in whatever you want into that box, we have an interpretation or an evaluation. Where the hardiness comes in is in the psychological interpretations and evaluations. It translates whatever those circumstances are from difficult and overwhelming and undermining into difficult yet manageable. Given the interpretation that something is difficult yet manageable, we will have a variable set of emotional, behavioral, and hormonal neuroendocrine reactions. Emotions and behaviors we might see directly or overtly. We see the way behaviorally that people are eating well or not eating well, sleeping well or not sleeping well, relaxing well or not relaxing well. What we don't see directly is what's going on inside the body. We don't see your hormones kicking in. We don't see your immune system responding. However, we can infer based on systematic scientific studies that there is some kind of response that can be measurable or measured that relates to health consequences. So the abstract model is your attitudes and beliefs influence how you're interpreting. Interpretations lead to positive or negative, whatever positive or negative means, and positive or negative responses of the body have health consequences. Here's where we're going next. And I flipped back. That interpretation is about what is important to you, what is meaningful to you. So what I'd like to do is engage you in a little brief activity, if you would. If you can find a piece of paper and a pencil or a pen, or if you get out a Word document, I would like you to list something. So if everyone would please get out a document, if you have a piece of paper, actually, I don't know if I can ask this, or can I ask everybody to, if they're willing to show their screen, show me a piece of paper that you have a piece of paper or you have a Word document open. And if you have a piece of paper, just show it. Show your, fantastic, get a pen out. And if you don't have a piece of paper, you can do it as a Word document, but it actually works better with a piece of paper, believe it or not, this exercise. Google Doc is open, that's fine, Giselle. And again, if you find a piece of paper, that's fine too. If you would, I'm gonna direct you in a way, and this is just for this exercise. This exercise is just a classroom exercise. However, if you would write down the 10 most important things to you, don't think about it too much because I'm only gonna give you about a minute to do so. Go ahead and write down anything that comes to mind. It could be your smartphone, or if you have a Ferrari, it could be your Ferrari, if that's what you're into. It could be peace, love, justice, God. It could be family, it could be health. It could be anything that's valuable, concrete or not. Anything that's in your life that's very important to you. However, in this exercise, it has to have 10 things on the list. So write the numbers vertically 1 through 10, if you haven't already. And please, if you would, write down the 10 most important things to you. And you have about 30 seconds left. So for those of you that are still writing, write fast. And I wonder whether someone would be brave enough to list their 10 most important things, 10 most important things. You may also know that there is a blog called the Pepper Perspective, and this exercise is listed in the Pepper Perspective blog. Eric just shared the link there. Can I push some folks? Marco, how far are you? You got 10?
I got 8.
8. So if it's things like family, break it apart and add like mom and dad or something like that, but it has to be 10.
Okay.
Who does not have 10? You need 10 for this exercise to work. I'm at 9. So Giselle, make one up. It could be simple, not important, but important. It's a funny way to say it. Giselle, do you have 10 yet? So Giselle, if you're willing to unmute, would you list your 10? And then I'll come back to Marco and then we'll continue on. Giselle, what are your 10?
So I have love, happiness, justice, quality time, art, music, family, my dogs, my friends, and baking.
Yay, great. Marco, what are yours?
Okay, I got music, nature, honesty, humility, turntables, trails, mountain biking, olive oil, water, family.
Fabulous. All right. So if you don't have 10, this won't make as much sense, but if you have 10, fantastic, great job. It'll be more meaningful in this way. I'm going to preface this statement by saying that it's an exercise just for this recording or just for this little mini class. If you would look at your list, and I would like you to cross off 3 of those 10. I'd like you to go now, cross off 3, 9, 8, 7, 6, 5, 4, 3, 2, 1 3/4, 1 1/2, 1 1/4. Finish up. All right. Marco, which ones did you cross off?
I crossed off trails, mountain biking, and olive oil.
Great. Giselle, which ones did you cross off?
Art, music, and baking.
Interesting. All right. How was that for you, Giselle?
I didn't like crossing stuff out.
Nobody does, right? These are the 10 most important things, and you tell me to cross off three of them. That's kind of crazy. Marco, how was it for you?
It was really, really rough.
Yeah. It was rough, right?
Yeah.
Right? Okay. Are we done with this exercise? No. Please now, for everyone, cross off three more. Go. 9, 8, 7, 6, 5, 4, 3, 2, 1 3/4, 1 1/2, 1 1/4. All right. I know I volunteered you both. Giselle, what were the four that were left?
I only crossed off one more because I'm having a hard time deciding what are the.
Okay. I'm going to give you a minute. Cross off a couple more. Marco, what were the four that you had left?
Music, nature, humility, and water.
Got it. Got it. And Giselle, were you able to get rid of a couple more? It's just an exercise.
Okay. My last ones are love, happiness, family, and my dogs.
Got it. Thank you. How was that now? Just with these four that are left. How was that? Marco, how is it for you crossing off three more and just leaving these four?
It's interesting. I was sad to cross off family.
Yeah. And it's temporary. It's just for a quick little exercise. Giselle, how is it for you?
Same thing. I don't like doing it. It makes me feel like I have to give it up, even if it's just an exercise.
Right. It's interesting. Yeah. All right. Are we done? Not with this exercise. We're almost done. If you would, for this exercise, knowing that it's temporary, please cross off three more. 9 seconds, 8 seconds, keep going, cross them off. 7, 6, 5, 4, 3, 2, 1 3/4, 1 1/2, 1 1/4. In the chat, it says, what was the one thing left on your list? This is for everybody. If you're willing, go ahead and drop into the chat the one most important thing for you at this time from your list. Giselle and Marco, what was it?
I was left with happiness.
Got it. Marco, what was it for you?
Nature.
Got it. Remember, if you ever do an exercise like this or this one, there's a variety of these, this type of exercise again, make sure you must give everything back to everybody. That is to say, they were never gone. These are an abstract thought experiment. Yet my argument is that your body responded. You might feel sadness, grief, loss. You might feel depression. You might feel anxiety, worry, concern, fear, projections onto the future. What if these things do go away? You might feel anger over the injustice. Hey, who are you to tell me what to get rid of? Strong emotions are part of this exercise, or could be, but remember, we try to buffer by saying that we can be challenged doing something that's difficult yet manageable. We can commit to the activity. It's short term. It's something within my ability to decide to engage in. And the last is I can control the process. And I also want to acknowledge everyone's engagement with what we just did as an activity. There's some amazing things that were clarified for folks. And notice that there wasn't an iPhone on the list. For some people, the most important thing is their phone or their social media connection. And again, it's an opportunity. I'd like to open up to any comments and questions while I share on the screen a little bit, again, for the recording, some of the details. There are references on this. It's microscopically small at the very bottom. VC, or values clarification compared to venture capitalism, you know, quickly list the 10 most important things, cross off three of them, cross off three more, leaving the one most important thing to you. Are there any comments and questions? You can just unmute or drop into the chat. Any comments and questions? Hardiness is a buffer. It basically says, how do you find meaning in what you're doing? And here is the argument that we're going to have. The argument is that when we find things that are difficult yet manageable, knowing that it's going to take twice as long as I was anticipating, or knowing that it might be, you know, a struggle, but it's worthwhile, we can not only have our heart rate go up as, yeah, these are difficult things. And at the same time, I don't want to have my muscles tighten, my body tighten, my blood vessels tighten when I squeeze my body versus when I say it's difficult, but I can loosen up my body. Now, one of the processes that I wanted to talk about was the notion of inflammation. Inflammation is a process that is caused when there's irritation or tissue damage. When we tighten up too much, we might rip and tear our muscles, and we might squeeze our blood vessels, and no warm blood flows and can't do its job. The system can't work as well when we are too tight, figuratively and literally speaking. When we have an attitude and a belief that something is difficult yet manageable, we might reduce the amount of time that we're tightening and bracing and squeezing and injuring the body. One of the challenges when the body is injured or damaged includes the process of inflammation. So I'd like to describe a process of inflammation in a moment. And here is the share screen. The example is when someone gets a splinter. So a splinter comes in to the skin along with a bunch of bacteria or viruses or other things that are on top of the skin, and they come into the body. There's some chemical signals, and the blood vessels have, in this conversation, two different kinds of cells. They have red blood cells and they have white blood cells. The name of the white blood cells in this conversation are called leukocytes, leu for white and cyte for cell. The red blood cells communicate clotting factors, things that say, I need to start the repair process. The white blood cells are there to protect against the invaders, the pathogens that come into the body. One of the jobs or the roles in this simplified cartoon is to eat the cell, where the words phagocytic leukocyte, phage, phagia for eating, cyte for cell. A phagocytic leukocyte is a type of white blood cell that figuratively or literally surrounds and starts dissolving and digesting the pathogens. So a process called phagocytosis is the process of eating the pathogens, as well the red blood cells sent the clotting factors into the wounded area where the splinter was, and we start a process of tissue rebuilding and cellular repair. The concept that I want you to take away is the movement of these cells, the red blood cells and the white blood cells, from the blood vessels, out of the blood vessels into the tissues that have been damaged. So there's a movement from one space, the blood vessels, to another space, the site of injury or the site of damage. Here is a little bit of a more technical slide with lots of technical terminology. Up on the upper right, it says direct injury. This could be toxic burns or chemicals or some other kind of problem. It could be a splinter. There's a bunch of technical language in relationship to how the chemicals get released, what those release of chemicals are, and there's another piece that I wanted to add, which is it's not just the cells themselves that are moving around in the blood vessels or the cells that are moving around in the tissues, but rather chemicals are also interacting back and forth. And the question is raised, what are those chemicals and what are the influences of those chemicals? One of the questions that I'd like to ask, and I have to say this is a trick question, is inflammation good or bad? And it's a trick question, and I don't expect an answer. The trick question, because it raises the limit of the way that questions are asked into a range of possibility that's just good, bad, right, wrong, yes, no, in its nature. A different question is when and where And why is it the case that inflammation could be good at times and can be bad at times? And that's where we're heading next. The when, the where, that's the location in the body, and the why is it the case that inflammatory process can be beneficial in the sense that inflammation can help the movement of debris, of damaged cells, cells that have been injured or damaged, need to be removed and taken away. And space needs to be made available so that those chemical repair processes can occur. There's a list of classic signs of inflammation, and I'm going to drop this into the chat. And again, this is about as technical as I want to get for the moment. But when inflammatory reactions occur, there's warmth or heat, there's discomfort or pain, there's color change or redness, there's opening or swelling that occurs. There's more recently this notion of scarcity and tightness that has also been added on by Sikashia. So the complicated slide that you see in front of you is a reminder. There's not going to be an exam on this talk. It's there for the recording. And I wanted to add in a couple of features of this very dense slide to orient you to it. First is this image that looks like a human. It's representing a person with a central nervous system that's responding to the pain and these chemicals that get sent out that include inflammatory chemicals, things that cause swelling. The movement of red blood cells in and out of the site of injury. So these little dots up at the upper left represent the red blood cells, and we might get redness. We get swelling. We get pain as the nervous cells, the nervous system gets stimulated in varying locations. There's one more piece that I wanted to add. There is a process of repair of tissue regeneration that sometimes includes tissue scarring. When we have too much injury or damage, the body goes through a process of repair. When we get healthy repair, we get everything kind of back to the way it was. Sometimes we get a scarring, which is not allowing the tissues, the cells, the blood vessels, the damaged areas to work as well. And I'm going to hit pause to say that there are many, many types of cells, each of which produce many, many kinds of chemicals. I say this because there's a dynamic process. If we go all the way back to the way that we started the talk today, the talk was exposure to difficulty, to toxic environments, to difficult life circumstances, whatever they are, whatever dramatic or traumatic experiences you might have felt, there are temporary short-term types of injury or damage. The body mostly has an immune system that can take care of or deal with those temporary disruptions at the teeny level, the level of the cells, the level of the tissues. However, sometimes the damage keeps reoccurring. And when we get chronic damage over and over again, instead of a healthy repair and tissue regeneration, we get tissue scarring and or not going back to the way things were. I'd like to hit pause because I'm about to shift gears again. Any comments and questions about the inflammatory reaction? Because the word inflammation is a placeholder for a whole course on what the body does in relationship to injury or damage. It also raises the question, what kind of injury or damage? The argument is as follows. We have difficult life circumstances, dramatic and traumatic events. The body tries to regenerate and repair itself following those difficulties. Sometimes the ongoing or repeated injury occurs, and we have an accumulated damage that's hard to repair at a certain point. So we move from the attitudes and the beliefs of an individual into the effect on the body and how we interpret difficult life circumstances can serve as a buffer for those life circumstances ending up in more permanent, long-term and enduring damage as opposed to relatively short-term, but difficult yet manageable, or in this conversation, difficult yet repairable tissues. Let me go ahead and move us to the next slide. So we're moving from the complex world of microcellular, lots of cells and lots of cell chemicals into the abstraction of excitation and inhibition. What does that mean? Some of these cells and some of these chemicals make our body go faster, excite or stimulate cellular process. Other cells and chemicals are inhibitory or shutting down. They slow down or stop. They suppress. The first word, myokine, myo is for muscle, kine is for chemistry. And the myokine suggests that our cells are widely distributed around the body and all around our body. We have cells and tissue types that would stimulate us or inhibit us. But what we want to know from a hardiness perspective is that it's worthwhile to investigate, to ask relevant questions, to start saying, you know what? I can't control the weather. I can't control the storms and the wildfires and the viruses that cause COVID. But what I can control are the following things. We can ask questions of what and when and where and who and why, and most importantly, how in this conversation. So the how I'd like to suggest in this starting point is the move your body how. You might not be able to run a marathon. You might not be able to, when you're watching Zoom, to take long breaks. But what you might be able to do, and this is going back to an earlier question at the beginning that Kelsey asked, it's like, why do people choose to quit work and sit in front of a screen all day long when we know that there's a great deal of fatigue? What are those high intensity interval training, HIIT activities might not be so high intensity. High sitting time is a behavioral risk factor for blunted improvement of depression across 8 weeks of COVID-19 pandemic is the title of the article. This is from Frontiers in Psychology. It's a very 2021, it's a very recent article. It was reported about in National Public Radio recently. The short answer is MYB, which is not mind your business, it's move your body. So I'd like to invite each of you to do a very, very simple movement of the body that has to do with your calf muscles. The skeletal muscles pump blood, the blood moves through vessels, the vessels have valves. Those vessels have valves to stop the movement backwards against gravity. So here's what I'd like us all to do. I'd like us to take a moment now, if you would, to stand. In a standing position, I'd like you to take the look at the back of your fingers and raise them up towards the ceiling so that you continue to look up against the back of your fingers. And then I'd like you to go onto your tiptoes. I'd like you to feel of the movement in your calf muscles. As your calf muscles, you can put your hands down, but your calf muscles are like a second heart. They pump the blood against gravity back up to the core organs and allow you to do more filtration, getting rid of all those stress hormones. If you would now, if you turn to the side and place your hands on your knees, place your hands on your knees. If you're able to do so, if you're not able to do so, don't. If you have an injured back, do not do this. But if you are able to, go ahead and put your hands on your knees. And then if you would take a slow breath out on your exhale, bring your palms below your knees to your shins. You should all feel a little bit more of a stretch in the back of the leg muscles, the hamstrings. Go ahead now, if you would, and take a long breath in for 4 or 5 seconds. And then on the exhale, bring your fingertips closer to your ankles. As you exhale, move your body. And now, if you would, on your next round, after a long breath in, feel the air coming in all around you, feel it coming into your back. And on the exhale, bring your hands back up to your knees, just partway. And then on the next round of exhale, come back to standing. And then we're going to shift again to seated posture. Just a quick check-in with you all. The purpose for that little stretch was to remind us that we circulate our blood when we are under strain conditions, our muscles tighten, our blood vessels tighten, and all those cells interact with each other, exchanging chemical communications. The chemical communications, if you allow that movement to be open and free, the body can do its job, it can repair itself well. When the cells and the chemistry kind of interact in a way and they get stuck in the tissue repair, the cellular damage repair does not occur as easily. That's an argument. And the argument is that when we can say difficult yet manageable as an attitude, we are going to allow the body to do what it does well. And when we say it's too much, it's overwhelming and undermining, I'm going to tighten up and brace, and my body does not regenerate as fully or as easily. I'm pausing briefly for comments and questions, a few more slides, and then we'll be finishing up.
Yes, I think you want to, Rick, just interrupt. You probably want to have questions in about 2 minutes or something.
Okay.
Possible. You know.
No problem. Yep. Then let me continue through these. Health behaviors are not just moving your body. They're also how we sleep. Sleep is a repair time. Synthesis and release of growth hormones occurs mostly at night so that the nighttime doesn't compete with the daytime activities of cardiorespiration, digestion, and temperature regulation. At nighttime, our temperature goes down. Our cardiorespiratory and digestive processes go down. What gets upregulated is synthesis and release of growth hormones, the repair molecules that help the body repair damage throughout the day. So sleep is number one. Brain-gut connection, food and mood. Whole lecture on sleep, a whole lecture on food and mood. So sleep well, eat well. The last is relax. Breathing is number one in this list. The breath is life in this conversation. What does that mean? Whether you're a firefighter, whether you're in a war zone, whether you're an entertainer, whether you're an athlete, whichever posture you hold while you're doing relaxation meditation techniques, breathing is central to all of those activities. The last piece, again, for the recording in this conversation is something that's microscopically small. Let me give you an outline. How does hardiness contribute to coping? There's letters A, B, C, and D. I'm simply going to describe them. You can always go back and look at the recording. We can always send this. There's a whole course on this kind of material. First is perspective building. Abstractly, it's reconstructing a situation in your mind. Situational reconstruction, reframing are other terms that are similar. The idea is, given the worst case that can happen, how likely is that to truly come about? Is there a better case story? What would have to happen in real life and in real time for the better case to come about? Developing a proportion or a percentage of likelihood allows you to build perspective about the likelihood of the best and worst case coming about, which would permit the attitude of difficult and manageable or difficult and undermining and overwhelming. Along the way with building perspective, you have some strong emotions. So part B is taking care of those anger, sadness, fear, boredom kinds of distractions that come along with your thought experiments. Thought experiment, you can reconstruct the situation, but you also have to deal with the strong emotional triggers that come along with it. Step C, what are those things that we can compensate for in order to improve our situation? And lastly, there's generating a set of options and a set of actions as a list. So you generate an options or an actions list. What information do you still need? What materials, things, money do you still need? What kind of encouragement do you still need? What do we do about this? It is described in some recent books. For example, how do we deal with technology stress? Among the things we can do is pay attention to our body. So for example, wearable devices that give us biofeedback information about when our muscles are tightening and when we're slouching and things along those lines will help us, as well as pay attention in order to shift your intention. Take stretch breaks, look around, check in with your breathing. And of course, sleep well, eat well, relax well. And we started the talk with this notion of courage. Courage is not always saving a person from a burning building or a soldier from a war zone. It's mostly taking those little bits of risk in service to growth and learning. Courage doesn't always roar. Sometimes courage is the quiet voice at the end of the day saying, I'll try again tomorrow. I'm going to stop there, open up for comments and questions.
Well, first of all, Rick, I want to thank you so much for sharing the information and doing, especially the values clarification practice, I find so useful, and just giving the framework. And it really reminds me that much of what health is about is living, is taking charge of yourself, which is often difficult. So on that note, please, those who have questions, please put them in the chat, or if it's comfortable, just ask out loud. And if there's no question, I'm going to reframe.
I have a question for them, but do you have a question for them?
I would have Kelsey's question. That is her initial question she started with. How come we are all stuck in front of screens in a way and choosing that lifestyle, even though it's unhealthy in a different way?
Well, I have an answer, but Kelsey might have an answer after today. Why is it that people would choose to press themselves? What is it in service to when they say, you know what? I'm not going back in the car. I value too much. I hold dear to me the convenience of being closer to home and with family than I do the personal struggles. And now the question could be, what else can they do to say, I can commit to influencing my world. I can get a better relationship with my physical space so that I don't have as many accumulating muscle strain and eye strain and neck strain. Or I can say, no, I'm sorry. I have to give myself 5 minutes or on either side of any meeting time. What is it that is possible? And how would you have the courage to speak up to say, you know what? I'm just overwhelmed. I can't have back-to-back-to-back meetings, as an example. I'm going to stop there. Tell me if that resonated at all. So Kelsey, what else would you add?
I do want to make really clear that I don't want to seem like insensitive to people's like circumstances about why some people are choosing to, like, it might not actually be a choice, you know, like, but where, yeah, like, I think that my interest is just like a lot more like maybe existential in terms of our society. Like, I kind of jumped to like, oh, everyone cites convenience as like why we want to stay at home. And why is that? Because we're so busy. We have so many things going on in our lives. And so like, then I'm like, how can we make it so that that's not the case? Like, how can we just have this whole like revamp of our entire world? Like where we're not so stressed out and busy all the time, where we can actually carve out time to be with people in person and like So it's like, it's so kind of giant like that is.
I'm going to use three phrases, complacency, idealism, and realism. Complacency is, why should I change? It's not perfect, but I figured out how to be okay with the way things are, as imperfect as they are. So that's a complacent attitude. When push comes to shove and somebody says, you got to change, often idealism kicks in. Well, if I'm going to change, then the perfect idealized experience would be, I'm going to have a sit stand desk and I'm going to have insulated sound walls and I'm going to have, breaks in between and I'm going to have everything lined up that's perfect. The distinction between complacency and idealism is often a thought experiment. Realism is what's likely to happen versus the best case scenario, but it might not be as perfectly likely to happen. So we distinguish between the psychological hardiness attitude versus the optimism attitude. Optimism is looking forward to the ideals, but hardiness is saying, nope, it's difficult. However, I can manage. It might take twice as long or 10 times as long as I think. I'm more in trouble when it takes 10 times as long, but I should expect things are going to take longer than I think because the thoughts are really fast and life can sometimes be much longer or slower than we thought. And so the questions are raised from a psychological hardiness perspective. Existence or existential questions are finding meaning, where finding meaning is, it didn't work the way that I thought it would. What is going on? So I can more be grounded in a realistic understanding or an assessment. Pain versus suffering. Pain is endemic. Difficulty is part of the struggle of life. Suffering is that psychological layer that adds on. And again, hardiness is about the existential suffering piece, not just the difficulty or the pain piece in a broadly stated way.
Well, Rick, I really thank you so much for your presentation. And I'm applauding you. And hopefully each of us found some real useful benefits in the practice. And just for Kelsey, it's remind the question she asked about being captured by computers and why people do that. I mean, there's a whole model that our technological world or any much of our pathophysiology that occurs is partially evoked by essentially reacting to evolutionary traps. We may be eating more sugar because we like sugar intrinsically because it allowed us to survive. We are captured by the screen because we keep looking at it because it's an early triggering pattern of that's danger, friend or foe. I can keep going. Rick and I wrote that in a book called Tech Stress, which has many, many hints. But for today, I want to thank each of you for coming and being present. Hopefully you want to share this with others as well. I want to thank Rick again for presenting. And I want to remind all of us that next week, we have another guest speaker. Let me find the speaker list for a moment and I'll post it on the slide. Here we are. It should be popping up maybe. Did it pop up? Yes. That next week, on the same time from 12 to 1, we have a colleague from Canada who is Dutch initially, Savas Mess, who is a remarkable physical therapist who will focus specifically on some of the aches and pains so many of us have in our lives with practices. And his presentation will be resolving neck, shoulder, and back pain with somatics, and thereby learn strategies for healthy aging and resolve these pains. It explores integral somatic health practices to understand and reduce the occurrences of comorbidities in human population. There are also cofactors in severe illness caused by COVID-19. As many of you may know, if you compare people who get COVID for seriously sick and die versus those who don't, people who are on the healthy side and do not get COVID exercise approximately 150 minutes a week, and while the people who get severe COVID don't. And finally, I want to remind all of you that if you're intrigued in more classes at San Francisco State, enroll in some of the classes which are part of general education, and can even be part of a minor or a major in parks and recreation. So without much ado, I'd like to thank each of you for participating and see you online again next week. If you have any questions, please contact Rick Harvey on his presentation. That's rharvey@sfsu.edu. And I will put into the chat my email address as well in case people have questions. And then I wish you all much joy for the week. Thank you so much for participating.
If you stop the recording, I'm welcome to stick around for comments.
Great, I'll stop the recording.